senior. I study stem cell research and global health and health policy. So, I'm Matthew. I'm a second year student and I study psychology.
Hi, I'm Bushra. I'm a sophomore and I also study psychology.
Hi, my name is Laura. I'm a fourth year student studying stem cell biology.
Hi, my name is Gia. I'm a third year student studying economics.
Hello, my name is Elisha. I'm a second year student studying computer science.
Hi, I'm Michael. I'm a fourth year student studying neurobiology.
Hi everyone, I'm Cindy. I'm a third year student studying history.
Hi everyone, my name is Kyle. I'm a third year student studying government.
Hi, I'm Annabelle. I'm a second year student studying computer science.
All right, let's start off with a question we all would like to know. How did you get into Harvard?
Universities. Main component obviously is your grades through high school. Your SAT scores have to meet a certain criteria. That's not to say, however, that you have to have perfect scores, because it's that's a pretty high bar. But the way that they offset that is actually looking at your extracurricular activities, how you're involved, whether or not you've done community service work and all that. So they really look for leadership potential and whether or not you can meet the academic rigor. In terms of how I personally got in, I was just very involved with a lot of leadership activities, mostly in terms of sports, very involved in the classroom, basically just a lot of I think the way that I got in was very much due to being well-rounded, not necessarily that I had a specific forte for really great academics, but I think it was well-rounded, and they take that into consideration whether or not you're well-rounded or if you're very talented in one specific aspect. I don't know if anyone else wants to add some more.
I agree with everything Michael said, and I think another thing is the interview. So that's one way that Harvard also gets to know you and see if you really fit into the culture, because it's like being able to meet or participate in all of the academic and extracurricular activities are very important, but also about you, your personality. Do you fit into the culture of the school? That's very important. And so I think I got that across through my interview, and yeah.
Yeah, so I think Michael and Gia have great points. I just wanted to bring up that your letters of recommendation also matter a lot. So when you choose letters of recommendation, it's really important that you choose people who know you well. It's not necessarily someone of high rank that matters, such as someone who you've worked with closely, either on a project or in school, a teacher, community leader. I also wanted to say that your application should reflect who you are as a person. It's your story, and you should try to show all the aspects of who you are. Obviously, that's very difficult because at the end of the day, it's like a pile of papers. But that's why you show your extracurriculars, your letters of recommendation, your interview, and also at the end of the day, your grades and your essay systems.
And I guess lastly, that was not mentioned is your essay. So in your essay, show your passion, show your story, she said. So I think I have really, really good essays that reflect who I am as a person, and I think that mattered a lot, and they actually told me that afterwards.
So to add on a little bit, how big was it to get into Harvard in your community, in your home, or how big was it?
it was a pretty huge deal for me and my family. Both my parents have like associate's degree, which is 2 year degrees. So it was crazy. I applied like on a whim with like my Texas State applications. Like I didn't think, yeah. So it was like a really good thing for me and my family. Just like I think everyone has a similar experience that like no one thinks they're going to get into Harvard, and then it's just a really great thing when it happens.
Yeah, I'd like to echo. I think my story is also something similar, in which my mom is a first-generation immigrant. She immigrated from Korea to America, and she didn't have the easiest time raising me as a single mother, but me getting in and also being one of the first people in my like small rural-ish town off of Austin, Texas, was a big deal for the community and for empowering other people. And I think that's something that wasn't mentioned earlier about getting to Harvard. It sounds like a lot of requirements, but Harvard also kind of looks at your application within the context of where you are and where you grew up. You know, if you're someone who has to work a lot in high school, so you're not able to do as many extracurriculars, they factor those kinds of things in as well. It's not just people who have the most resources and opportunities to get as many things down on their resume and so forth.
As you can see, I think it's pretty different from the Thai way of getting into university, because like here, we mostly got into like there's different ways as well, but mostly through entrance exams, so mostly just exams. They don't really look at the extracurricular that much. But as you can see that in the States, in Harvard, they actually look in a well-rounded way, so to speak, not just academically, so that's really important. And really interesting, a different view from what you would get used to in Thailand. So the next question is that when and how did you choose your major?
So I like to say that I ended up majoring in computer science almost by accident. I did not plan to study this at all. In fact, before college, I was firmly opposed to computer science. I didn't really like the idea. I thought it was just, you know, you being hunched over a computer 24/7, that did not appeal to me. Even though my dad is a software engineer, so he was very sad that I wasn't interested. But the great thing about Harvard and I guess American universities in general is that at least your first year and a half or so are meant for you to explore different tracks and take a lot of introductory courses so you can figure out what subject appeals to you most, because a lot of things that a university offers, you would not be able to experience in high school. So for me, computer science was one of those things, and after I took my first class, I found that it was a very different experience from what I expected. It was a lot more interactive and interesting, so I decided to switch.
I'm going to add on to that very quickly. I also, before I came to Harvard, I was not expecting that I'll study computer science. I was planning to not take math or any like STEM-related classes all 4 years. But then, first semester of my freshman year, I took the intro to computer science class. It was my first CS class, and then I just like found it to be like very interesting, and realized that like there's like an entire field that I've never explored before that's like actually really interesting. So I kept on taking like more computer science classes and realized that I really like it.
Yeah. Other majors?
So for me, I kind of knew coming into college that I wanted to study history just because I had like a really good experience with the history department and teachers in my high school. So I knew what I liked and I knew what I didn't like, which was anything in the STEM area. But however, that said, I think that having that year and a half to decide and explore whatever classes you would like was important, like affirming my confidence that like I would enjoy history. And if I like freshman year, if I like taken history classes that were terrible or heard that like history professors were not that great, then I would have made a different decision, but that was not the case, so, yeah.
Because like, I think that's actually a very interesting point, because again, in Thailand it's very different. You choose your major applying into university. So like, there are cases, a lot of cases actually, that when you actually study in that major and then you found that that's not the one for you, so you reapply, so you have to become a freshman again. That actually happens a lot in Thailand, and obviously that's not the case in the US because you've got to explore your passions and a lot of classes, so I think that's really interesting.
How many classes do you take per semester and how is it conducted?
So if you're a freshman, you have to take four classes your first semester. You can, however, take something called a freshman seminar, which is like a class that isn't really homework intensive. It's just more come to class, discuss, and learn. So there's a nice little like stepping stone for like the more rigorous academics into your sophomore and junior years. After that, after your freshman fall, you can take anywhere from 3 to 8 classes for the entire your entire academic career. Now, not many people take like 6 to 8 because that's hard. Okay. Now, I have taken 5 classes for 3 semesters, and that's just because I couldn't eliminate one. But most of my peers take 4 per semester. And if you take 4 per semester, you're on track to graduate in 4 years. And I believe 98% have students graduate in 4 years, something like that. So now this semester, because I'm a senior, I'm taking 3 classes, and it's great. I highly recommend.
So also for classes, usually there's lectures and sections. So most of the classes have about 2 lectures a week, and then they meet on Monday, Wednesdays, or Tuesday, Thursdays. But then they also have a smaller like discussion-based group called sections. And this you can like enroll into like times that fit your schedule. Some people end up in like a 9 a.m. Monday section. That's pretty unfortunate. But other people also flexibly adjust based on like what their preferences are and what their schedules are. And for me personally, I find the sections to be rewarding because at lectures you learn a lot, but sections is where all the discussion and participation happens. So you actually get to explore the topics more in depth and detail.
So one thing that's, I think, pretty unique to Harvard in terms of classes is what we call Shopping Week, which is the first week of every semester is basically for students to explore any class that they want to. Almost every class, unless it's a, I guess it'd be like a graduate class or a very, very small, like a seminar or something, but every lecture and mostly every large size class will be open for students to come in, sit, observe the lecture, see if they want to take the class. And then after this week is when we choose our classes and enroll. So this has been very helpful for me. Like, at, I think there has only been one semester where I knew all 4 classes that I was going to take. But every other time I've had to use Shopping Week to explore multiple classes and see which one do I like best.
Also with the class at Harvard, they have this like pretty cool concept where you take classes pass-fail or you even audit classes. And so what that means is if you take class pass-fail, you don't have to worry about what grade you get, just as long as you end up passing class. And that's really helpful for, say, so I'm studying neurobiology. If I wanted to go and study take a history class and not worry about that, like what grade I would get, I could take pass-fail and just to explore it. And that's one of the great things that you have this like academic freedom that's allowed to you. And then in terms of auditing a class, you basically can just sit in on any class that you like. You don't have to do the work. You're just there to learn and absorb the material. And again, that's something that really is great for fostering learning.
One other thing that's really cool about Harvard is you get to cross-register in other schools like MIT,
the business school and like Tufts and the law school. So basically, you're at Harvard, but you can also take classes at MIT. I have friends who are taking like 3 out of 4 of their classes at MIT because they're like, so Harvard is like a liberal arts college, so there are classes that like other universities offer that we don't offer. So sometimes it's like really, it would be like really useful if you can take like a finance class or like a computer science class that's like different from what Harvard offers. So that's something that's really cool, and it counts for your credits, and the grades also show up in your transcripts. So it's like a very, it's like a thing that a lot of Harvard students do as well.
So, in Thailand, we do take those classes, but we have these classes called Gen Eds. So,
general education, for short.
Can you guys tell me about Gen Eds in Harvard?
So at Harvard, they have the general education program as well, since it is a liberal arts school. It's not a pre-career school. We don't have like a business major or like a law major. They are only more specific studies because it's liberal arts. But in accordance with a past president saying of a well-educated man should know a little bit about everything and then one thing really, really well, Harvard kind of follows that model where they require all their students to take at least one course in each of the general education fields. If someone really quickly wants to grab them all. Cultural belief, there's
aesthetic education,
ethical reasoning. They sound really complicated. Basically, it's like histories, like culture, different sciences, math, etc. But Harvard offers like thousands of courses, and in terms of majors, there's about 48, I want to say, majors that you can pick, and there's 47 secondaries or minors you can pick. And Harvard also does this thing where if you have a very specific thing you want to study, I have a friend who's really into philosophy and physics. He proposed to Harvard to make a new major, like a special major for him to study this, and they let him. So if you just have a good reason to study something kind of different and you explain it to them, the school will probably be very understanding and supportive.
Sorry, one last thing about classes. Similar to that, if you want a class and it's not available, you can petition the university to bring it, especially if it's a language course. I believe you only need 2 other peers to join your class and then they bring the professor. So my roommate brought like a tribal language to the university. She's taking it, she's having a great time. And I also had a friend who created his own competition. It was called it was like nuclear science from both the science perspective, but also the policy perspective. So he worked at both MIT and the Kennedy School at the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard, and that was like those were his classes. And then they also funded his trips abroad so he could study this stuff.
Yeah, back to the languages. I'm taking Intro to Thai. So I'm taking with one other student, and he's a monk, and we learn 3 times a week, and it's very awesome and pleasant.
Like, it seems like it has a lot of freedom in terms of education. It's even hard for us to go across faculty to study. Like, some classes we're not allowed to actually participate. So, like, I'm really jealous. Okay, so, like, in our class, what about extracurricular activities? Like, what are some of the popular extracurricular activities Harvard kids do? Or, like, what do you personally do for these activities?
There's just like a flood of organizations that you can join, ranging from student publication to athletics, the arts, pre-professional politics. So really you can like find an organization in basically any field that you may be interested in. Personally, I'm involved with the Harvard Political Review, which is a student-run quarterly magazine. I do Club Lacrosse, and do HCAP. And even like there are other like organizations that are like similar to HCAP and like cultural exchange traveling type of stuff. There's like mock trial debate. There's like a whole list of things that you can join.
During the beginning of the school year, every year. All the student organizations I like to go to, even if I have no interest in the club. And Harvard funds this by putting out an entire picnic dinner. And Harvard itself gives a lot of funding to our undergraduate organizations. So I'm involved in both cultural organizations, some political organizations, and also Harvard really cares a lot about our undergraduate life. So it funds both in-house, we'll get to this later, but in-house activities and out-of-house activities.
Yeah, one thing that I think is really cool about extracurriculars at Harvard is that it's very flexible. A lot of people could try out many different things, and then if it doesn't fit, you can always try something else, or if you like it, you can commit a lot of your time and resources to it. I personally like that one, like in a plethora of organizations. I've joined probably 10 to 15 of them, and then I kind of dropped out and then joined again. I thoroughly enjoyed the diversity of the experiences that you can get. I was at high school, I was pretty much focused just on debate and mock trial and a lot of forensics activities, but then when I came to college, I wanted to branch out, so I just randomly joined a breakdancing team for a semester, and then I went to, a model congress thing, and then so basically it just really helps to figure out what you really like, and that amount of flexibility definitely exists in the extracurricular scene.
So if you don't
sorry.
And if you don't find the extracurricular that you like, you can also start your own. So I personally got really involved in blockchain technology last year in the beginning of this year, and I realized that the undergraduate level does not have any resources to help fulfill that education. So I set out an interest form to a few email lists with a few of my friends, and we had about 300 students who said they'd be interested if we started a club, and so we did. So now we have the Harvard undergraduate blockchain group. So you can always start your own if you don't find an outlet that you like.
What's the student accommodation in Harvard, and how do you choose your dorm, and do you all live in a dorm?
So freshman year, all the freshmen are sorted into one of the dorms around the yard, Harvard Yard. It's basically a huge lawn surrounded by old-looking houses, and that's where all the freshmen live. The way they sort you into the dorms is they would send out a survey in around May-ish, before right after you get accepted. Then you fill the survey, ask you about your sleeping habits, your music preferences, and if you're a more social person, or do you enjoy downtime by yourself. So they look at the survey, and then they put you with people that they think will get along with you. So that's how they put freshmen into dorms. And then around February, March of freshman year, everyone gets into walking groups of one to eight. Sorry. So everyone formed walking groups of 1 to 8 people. It's usually it can either be a friend group or the people that you roomed with originally freshman year. And then in March we have a day called Housing Day. So we have 12 houses. They're all really great, and they're all very unique in their own ways. And then you submit your blocking group forms, and then they would randomly sort you. Well, they would run it through a lottery, and then they would randomly sort you into one of the houses. And then in March, there would be a day called Housing Day, where everyone gets up really early in the morning, and all the upperclassmen, so all the sophomore, junior, and seniors, would wear t-shirts or gears representing their houses. And then they would storm into your room, yelling in the house that you got into. And then that's how you find out which house you're in. And then that would be your house for the next 3 years. That's a very, it's like a very special day at Harvard. It's one of the few days when everyone's very just like very festive and love their school. Or love their houses.
Yeah, 99% of kids live on campus just because it's so convenient. I think I walk like 10 minutes to get to my class from my dorm. And Cambridge is so expensive, either way it's like more affordable to be on campus. Each house has their own dining hall, so it's very close. Each house has their own library to study in. And there's like a very great sense of community in each one. Each one's different, unique, and you can like be very involved in your house life, and like for a housing day, then you can like be very festive and like wear, I don't know, I saw people like wear like a penguin costume because like their house like animal or motto is like the penguins, Quincy. Yeah. And actually, to go back to the first point about freshman year, sometimes they also put you with people they think that you won't get along with and force you to get along with other people who are in your I've heard about one house administrator putting three people with the same name in the same room on purpose, just because they thought it'd be funny. Or they'll put you, usually like someone from the south and someone from the north together or something like that. They try to really mix it and give you a very diverse experience coming from.
Yeah, one other thing is I heard a similar thing as well. I'm an international student from Korea, and mostly a lot of the international students get roomed with a lot of American students, so I've never seen a room personally where they have more than like one international student in one room, and that was also like a really good experience for me coming to the States and like just trying to adjust to the culture. Having a lot of American roommates helped. That's one way they really kind of enrich, I think, dormitory life.
So one more thing that I wanted to touch on was it was brought up that the houses have this really vibrant community. And so basically it makes each house feel not necessarily just like a dorm that you're gonna sleep in, but a home that you can come to. Most of the, we call them like house masters, or they're technically changing that now, but or deans, and the tutors at the house are very accessible. They just really care about you and making you feel at home there. They'll have just random like snacks out sometimes, hold special events. Like for example, in my house, there's a balcony at the top, and sometimes you just like have a fire up there, like roasting marshmallows, just having a great time. There's just so many like sponsored events at the house to really make it feel like a place where you belong.
I just want to add to that really fast about having snacks out. So so during final period last semester, I had a final on the last day of school, so I was one of the people who like stayed there till the very end. And then we were all just like studying in the dining hall till very late. I think it was 2 a.m. This one day when our house dean came into the D hall, came into the dining hall with like a basket of snacks, and he just went around the D hall like giving everyone snacks and saying like, what exam do you have? Like, how's the studying going? Like, good luck with your exam tomorrow. And just being like very warm and sweet, it just like feels very at home. And like, I felt like very supported.
So it seems like Harvard has all these houses at the house animals. So do you guys compete against each house, or what do you do between the houses?
So, I'm in that house, and the house right next door to us is Dunster House. And we have a pretty intense rivalry because Dunster is pretty and we're not. So the architecture of our house is really ugly, and the architecture of their house is like neocolonial, so it's like beautiful, and they just remodeled it 2 years ago. So we have this intense rivalry. We're also in the same neighborhood, and So we compete on every level, including sports. So there's a pretty robust intramural program. So each house kind of has its own team, and the teams compete across different sports, even sports that don't really exist. So there's one sport called broomball that like my roommates are really into, where it's like hockey, but you're just hitting a ball with a stick. So my roommates really like that one. There's also, we have the normal sports like basketball. We have also my frisbee. We have squash. So in my house recently, we 2 years ago decided that we wanted to win at IMs again against Dunster. So our faculty deans, formerly house masters, gave a lot of money into the IM program, and basically they just like made it exciting to go compete. And so now we're number one in IMs. So now if you like compete in a sport in my house, you like get a jersey, and like there are like parties if you win a game. So it's just like a really fun way to exercise with your house, take a little break from work. We also have these things called house-sponsored study breaks where you take a coffee hour, it's fine, but holding bells is the best one.
Yeah.
And also really fun house activities. And I love my house.
So can you describe Cambridge and Boston? What is
cold.
It like to
It's cold.
Well, I'm originally from Boston. I've been there for 12, 13 years, and yes, it is cold and unpredictable. So, before we left for Bangkok, there was a snowstorm about 6 inches, which is about this much, and we were all afraid that our flights would be delayed. And now that we're here, just 2 days ago, they got about 2 feet of snow, so that's a lot. And that's Cambridge. Well, also a little bit of history. This is one of the oldest cities in America. So architecture over there is kind of amazing. A lot of old houses, brick, red. So that's kind of the theme. Anybody want to add?
So it's kind of, with Cambridge calling it a city is kind of iffy. Just because it's not like what you think is like a traditional city is like New York or Los Angeles or Bangkok. It's this kind of like hybrid between suburban and urban, where there's lots of greenery, but also lots of like stores, cars, like honking, you know, regular city bustle. But that makes it feel like basically not as like hustle and bustle, where it's a little slower paced in Cambridge rather than in New York City.
So one thing about the Cambridge-Boston area in general is that it's there's a high concentration of college students. It's a very young area. I think the average age of everyone living there is around 30 because there are so many colleges and there are so many college students. And so you get to interact a lot, especially if you're from this area, with students at other neighboring colleges. Especially if you go across the river from Cambridge to Boston. So I think that's one really nice thing about the city. It feels like what we call a college town. There are some other universities in very remote areas, rural areas, where the college is really the only thing there. And there are other universities where the area is so urban that they need to be spread out over the city. But Harvard kind of has its area to itself, and then around it feels very much like a college town.
So what are some of the activities that would you recommend? If I go to Boston, what would you recommend me do? Like what are some activities that you recommend? Or places to visit, things like that?
Just one quick one, the Freedom Trail. It's basically kind of like a map that you can either read on your phone or have a tour guide, and they just show you all the historical sites of Boston, and it's really cool. You can see Paul Revere's house and other really historical sites of Boston, so that's like a must that you have to do.
I think the cool thing about Boston is that there's a little bit of everything for you to see. So if you're like an arts person, there are a lot of museums. If you like food, there's food. Not as good as Thai food, but there's also a lot of, if you like academia or like looking at architecture, there's like MIT, Harvard, Tufts, and Houston, and lots of beautiful universities around the area. Yeah, so there's a little bit of everything for everyone. If you like summer, I don't recommend it. but other than that, it's beautiful.
But if you do go in the summer, there's a lot of whale watching that you can do, because we're right on the water. And also the John Harvard statue is like the second most photographed statue in the world, I think. So definitely go see that.
So what do you do after you graduate? That's a dumb question.
Okay, so I am a senior in senior spring. My concentration is stem cell research, and my secondary is global health and health policy. I also like Middle Eastern politics and Arabic. So the answer is, I don't know. But that's okay, because at Harvard you have the Office of Career Services, which is like this literal building full of resources for you where you can go talk to experts in basically any field. And they have events around the clock. Every single week they have an event in a different sector, and you can explore any job or career you would like. Another cool thing is that Harvard's a liberal arts university. So you're exploring different fields, but you're also kind of a generalist. Like, you've studied a little bit of everything, so you can go into whatever you like. The point of Harvard is that it equips you with the skills you need to go into any sector, really. You know, even if I'm stem cell research, I basically learned the tools of analysis, asking questions, you know, following my heart. And so that I could use that in any sector. I think for me the hardest part is like Harvard has made me fall in love with a little bit of everything. So now I'm stuck asking myself, where do I go next? But that's okay. Everything will be okay. Yeah.
I guess since I'm a senior, I should obligatorily say what I'm going to do after college. I also study stem cell biology. That said, my career is going to have nothing to do with biology. I'm going into management consulting.
On the other hand, I'm studying neurobiology and I intend for my career to be very biology focused. Looking at more of like biotech, pharmaceutical, and wherever really that takes me, whether that be maybe even going to grad school, which is very much an option that you can do right out of college. Yeah, it just opens up so many doors in whatever realm you want.
So that's very interesting, like about your life in Boston and in Harvard in general. So let's talk about like the time you have in Thailand. So what are some of the expectations that you have previously before coming to Thailand? And what are the reality of Thailand? Like, is there any difference? Like,
like,
can you share what you think, your thoughts about this?
I expected wonderful food, and I got wonderful food. Yeah.
I'm going to be more savage. I expected heat. I got heat.
So we had our delegates visit us in January, and they were wonderful. I don't think that I was expecting to come here and meet so many more people that I would love. So that's been really great. Can't stop it. Love it. No, but seriously, it's been amazing. And honestly, I see problems and be like, this has been an amazing week. Also, you have a lot of mosquitoes.
So HCAP is a cultural exchange program, right? And it's like Thailand, United States, we all think very different, right? But throughout this week, after all of the academic sessions, going out, touring the cities and areas around, one thing I did not expect is that we're really not so different.
So the next will be open for questions from the audience. Anyone would want to ask any questions?
Have you ever experienced the burnout syndrome? I mean, feel really exhausted, and how to deal with it, how to motivate yourself. And another question is, can you share about your fear and how to deal with it?
Can you repeat that question?
Have you ever experienced the burnout syndrome? So I think that being at Harvard is stressful in and of itself. I mean, we all have incredible classes, but also with those classes comes work. And also because we love our extracurricular activities, that also piles on more work. And then depending on what time of year, you're probably like also doing other work for jobs or whatever. So yeah, sometimes we take on a lot on our plates. And the cool thing about Harvard is that it has institutions in place that can help you out a little bit. So we are really big about mental health awareness on campus. We could be better, but like Harvard's doing a lot already for that. So at any point, should you need to talk to any mental health professional, you could walk in or just call, and it'll be covered by your insurance for free. Obviously, it's confidential, all of that. You also have resources in your own houses. So in my house, we have my team, Luke. If you ever like go up to him and you're like, hey, I'm having a hard time, you can go into his office, he'll sit you down, we'll talk. And then if necessary, you can either like take a day or two off, or even if you feel like you need more time to yourself or just to recover, you can even take a semester off to either work, explore, relax, just that. You also asked about fear. So earlier we did the DISC thing, and I am a dominant personality. So I can tell you confidently that my fear is failure. Yeah, and I haven't really gotten over the fear of failure, you know, it's always there. But I think one thing that's always in the background is like the fact that everything will be okay. You know, we're really young, and I've had an opportunity to meet a lot of alumni, and I'm always like, hey, did you know what you were doing senior year? And they were like, no. And now I'm fine, so I should be fine.
I'll talk about the fear a little bit. It's something that Harvard students talk about a lot called the imposter syndrome, which is just basically thinking like I'm the one person who doesn't belong at this school. Like the admissions office like made a mistake, like I shouldn't have gotten a letter. And like the past three semesters I felt that like extremely like just adjusting to college. And just like this semester I really just like focused in on like my passion and really like remember like why I'm studying what I'm studying, and it's completely different from everyone else's. Everyone has their own like path, and you just have to like remember not to compare yourself to others. In high school we all had the same goal going to college, and now everyone has different goals, like whatever you're going to do for the rest of your life, you know, what are you studying, etc. And just remembering that like what you're doing matters and is valuable.
So I'll talk a bit about the strategy part. So Maggie and I are actually both in the Seneca, which is this women's society. That's really uplifting because we meet every Wednesday and we're able to, you know, discuss, you know, everything that's on our mind. But about 2 weeks ago, an alumni was speaking with us, and she said the way that she used to deal with things was, if she was like stressed out for an exam, she'd be sitting, you know, in her room studying, and she was like, just imagine you studying in that room on that desk, and then zoom out a little bit and you'll see her sitting, and zoom out a little bit more, keep zooming out in your head until you see the entire world. You realize that in the grand scheme of things, you don't really matter that much. That one test is not gonna matter. And like, imagine yourself in 10 years, you're not gonna remember the stress that you dealt with, so just don't worry too much about it.
I guess in terms of fear, I'll just say that I think we all share pretty similar, like, just basic human fears. I think something you see particularly on Harvard's campus is this idea of optionality and this fear of not picking the right thing or like picking something, and by choosing that opportunity you're closing other doors that maybe you would have been done better at or could have been better for you. So I think that is a fear that a lot of Harvard students feel and can at times kind of inhibit them. I just want to say a note about being burnt out. I think all college students across the world feel burnt out at some point. But at Harvard, like Nora talks about, there are a lot of different strategies that you can employ when those kinds of things happen. For me personally, when I was a sophomore, my fall semester, I was having a really hard time, and I was thinking about taking time off school, and then some things happened at home and that actually forced me to take time off school to tell my family. So I took time off school. I actually took 3 semesters away from Harvard, where I traveled around the world. I worked at a startup in New York. I spent a lot of time at home thinking about what to do next. And I don't think that's a particularly uncommon thing, actually. Students take time off school all the time at Harvard. And it's not something necessarily to feel like is not an option or is inaccessible. I think people are scared to do it, but the reality is, like, people have FOMO, fear of missing out. But the reality is you come back to Harvard and Harvard is still the same. It's been there for 300, 400, it's been there for a bazillion years. It's gonna be the same. And taking care of yourself is something really important that I think Harvard students may not be the best at. So, yeah.
Yeah, regarding burnout, I honestly burn out at the end of every single semester. It's really the breaks that re-energize me, and also extracurriculars. HCAP is definitely one of those, because coming to a different country in the spring break, meeting all of them, meeting all of you guys is another thing that energizes me and gives me like a little bit more motivation to get through the next couple of months. Yes.
A lot of complaints about burnout and just wanted to touch on. But one thing that is, I think, hard for a lot of Harvard students is that, or maybe, I'm not sure, but this is true for me. I'm always a little nervous to talk to people about if I'm having a hard time and so forth, because there is always someone who's having a worse time than me. And so it's kind of a double-edged sword in the sense that we are all going through a very stressful time. And so in that way, that's kind of almost uplifting to know that you're not the only one who's struggling. But at the same time, it can sometimes be difficult to talk about your struggles just because you feel like they're somewhat less than others. And I think that's one thing that our campus could work on improving, just the culture around being vulnerable and talking about how you're feeling burnt out, what you're afraid of. It's very difficult at Harvard to admit that you're having a hard time, because it just seems like a campus where everyone else is like managing so many different things and is doing really well in all of them. But in reality, I think the fact that we all reacted so strongly to this question shows that everyone is struggling. It's a universal college experience.
Yeah, I guess not to try and reiterate what everyone else has been saying, but a good thing that helps me in terms of when I get burnt out or when I'm afraid of something or I think that my whole world is crashing down on me, it's to change the perspective that I'm looking at. And I mean that by, when you're in college, your only perspective is grades or academics and how that will affect your future and how future employers may look at that or all of that. You're just thinking about the future. But sometimes you just take a step back and you look at yourself. You have to say, I'm important. I should be happy. I want to pursue my passions. Find that flame inside of you, that passion, and just do what makes you happy. It doesn't matter whether or not you fail a test. I've failed. I've thought, oh no, like there's no way I'm ever going to be employed. It's not the case. You can fail. And in fact, I highly recommend failing at this age. It's a point in your life where you can do whatever you want. And people are going to tell you that you can't, but you can. And just constantly believe in yourself and harness that energy. And just good luck to everyone who's feeling. I mean that in the most endearing way of you will get through it. It can be tough, but everyone has been there. But just finding what's important to you and pursuing that, it really helps me personally. I hope that anyone else that feels that way, it'll help them as well.
Yeah. Thank you. I agree with everything that Michael said, and I was sort of along the similar lines. I was about to say that for me, an important means of dealing with burnout is to just like realize that I can say no and like quit to certain things, because I think that I'm constantly signing off of things, oftentimes because I feel like I need to be productive and doing something meaningful every hour of my life. And really try to think about the things that are meaningful to you and make you feel good about your life. Then you are less afraid of just like quitting. Because ultimately, I mean, I think we'll all agree that, I mean, your goal in life is to be happy and to feel good about yourself. So if that means, for example, for me, like just not doing certain clubs or organizations and spending more time with just friends, like then I think I can make that decision and not feel guilty about that.
I think my biggest fear was not living up to the expectations of other people, and that's been a serious problem because from where I come from, there were a lot of, at my high school, there were a lot of people who were high performing, high achieving, very ambitious. And then I moved to a college where there was a lot of people who are ambitious, very high performing, high competitive. And I just gotten used to this environment of what's the next thing, you know? Like, do you need to do something better? Do you need to keep on succeeding? And if you don't, if you just slip or fail, make one small mistake, then everyone's gonna be disappointed or everyone's gonna start looking at you as a failure. And that worked out up until a certain point. And then I had to take time off to serve in the Korean Army. And during those 2 years, I felt a lot of internal stress because I could feel that everyone I knew was kind of going ahead in life, doing things, clubs, jobs, whatever, while I was stuck behind. And I had to find a way of dealing with that kind of stress. And the way I think I tried to internalize that was figuring out that the competition really shouldn't be with the other people or like what others expect you to do, but I tried to make that about myself. So whether I'm becoming a better person than I was yesterday, if I'm learning something more, if I'm improving in any way, should be the metric of measuring my worth rather than like, am I doing better than the person next to me or the person in my community? And I don't know if I'm like still doing that. Like, I can still feel that I'm always very dependent on other metrics of evaluation, but I think that's one way you can probably try to tackle that issue.
I feel like one of my biggest fears at Harvard is FOMO, the fear of missing out, and I feel like a lot of people at Harvard have the same problem because there are like so many things that you can do at Harvard, like either academically or like extracurricular-wise, or just like socializing, like hanging out with friends or like going to like social events kind of thing. And then we tend to feel that if I don't show up at this event, if I don't show up at this my friend's birthday party, my friend's gonna be disappointed and decide to not be my friend anymore. Or if I don't show up at this recruiting event, I will never get the job. And that's like a problem that I always have, and I end up like overcommitting myself to everything. But then I realized that there are only 24 hours in a day, and there are only that many things that I can do. And like, instead of trying to commit to everything and end up being like like very stressed out and like not being able to do everything perfectly, I realized that it's more important to like pick out the things that I really, that I think matter the most to me, and then being like putting more efforts into those things and like actually accomplishing something that's like more meaningful. So that's like what I've been telling myself every day, just like stop feeling like, oh, like everyone's gonna turn on me if I don't like show up to certain events, or like if I don't commit to like certain classes or like certain clubs, and just like actually focus on the things that I like and focus on the things that I think are the most meaningful to me.
Questions? More questions? That was a long question.
I just think that that's like very insightful, and I think like everyone can relate to that, like, because like we're also in a quite highly competitive environment here as well, so like I think everyone can relate, and I think all of you guys talk, like there's like some really useful insights that we all could really adapt and use it, because like, I don't think Thailand is quite as aware of, in terms of like, you know, psychological well-being as the US. It's starting, but like it's not at that level yet. So I think this is very eye-opening for a lot of us, and I think it's really good. Any other questions, guys?
I have a question.
Sure.
You don't need, you all don't need to answer. Just a quick question. How do you feel bearing the name tag Harvard?
So when people ask me where I go to school, I first say the East Coast. Then if they ask where, then I say Boston. Then if they again ask where, then I say Harvard. It's a strange experience because I like almost hiding the school that I attend in a way, but I just feel like we have a phrase for this. It's called dropping the H-bomb. You say, oh, I go to Harvard. When I say that straight out, I feel almost like I'm bragging about it. And I think that has come after realizing like what a privilege it is to attend this school. So that's something that I find a little awkward, and that also goes along with the imposter syndrome that Maggie mentioned about feeling like I don't belong at Harvard sometimes. So yeah, I think I'm trying to be more, I guess, accepting of where I go. I'm trying to, you know, strike a balance between being proud of it, but not being prideful.
I agree with what Elijah just said, but also I've been thinking about it recently, like on the other hand, like having the name Harvard like really does help you a lot in life. Well, not in life, but like in different situations, because I feel like there are times when if you're, let's say if you're like trying to network with people, people tend to like be more willing to listen to you if you like drop the H-bomb, because it's really bad, but I feel like there are a lot of times when like people just think that you're more legit when you tell them that you're from Harvard, and then they would have like the patience of like listening to like what you're about to say. On the other hand, if one's from like a less well-known school, people might not be like as willing, or like might not give as much patience to like listen to like what you're about to say. So I think like with that said, like I also feel like very lucky and very privileged to be a Harvard student and have like the opportunity to like network with people or just like talk to people and like have them being like willing to listen to me.
Like, even though it's because, even though they're like patient because I dropped the H-bomb, but it's also like, it helps me tremendously with like conveying my message and like getting, yeah, like studying the message across.
At the end of the day though, like us going to Harvard, like it's just a name, it's just a label, it doesn't define who I am as a person. And like going, whatever school you go to, you can excel in it, you can excel there, and you can excel in life. Like, there are a lot of resources at Harvard, but I don't, like, what Elisha was saying, it doesn't make me, like, better than, like, someone else who doesn't, like, go to Harvard. It's just, like, such a weird, like, game, and, like, the whole system, it's just, I don't know, it just makes me uncomfortable, because, like, I have all, like, all of my friends from high school, like, are so great, and, like, everyone's gonna be fine, everyone's gonna be successful. It's just a matter of like time and effort, no matter where you are.
I agree a lot of what Maggie said, but I also just like think I became more comfortable with it. Like, honestly, at this point, I sometimes even enjoy dispelling the stereotypes associated with Harvard. Like, there are obviously expectations from other people thinking that you're, I don't know, like a genius, you stay at the library till 4 a.m. like, you're perfect. I'm none of those things. I personally have a lot of flaws that a lot of delegates here are aware of. And like, I don't know, I feel like Harvard is also just a place where people live. It's normal. Like, students are students and people are people. And in my mind, like, people are going to respect the fact that you went to Harvard, even if you don't like brag about it or like be super conscious about the label. So if you just like act naturally and be yourself, I think people tend to be a lot more accepting of you as who you are rather than like the school name that you're associated with.
Any other questions?
You can ask the questions to Ty as well, and we do have a translator on the spot. Okay, that's too great mood here, so it's getting a bit more stressful. And anyway, okay, so I realized that I feel like as a Chulalongkorn student and also as a Harvard student, I feel like we share a lot of experiences and also some similar, you know, feelings about the name tag or about the stress, the flow and everything. So anyways, I just want to move towards another direction. So nothing about stress or academics. So I was just wondering, because what do you do in your free time? Like, other than extracurricular activities or studying, like for us, like we do the same things, but I mean on the same time, like I enjoy my weekends. I would like to like binge watch Netflix like all day. Like, do you guys do something similar? Like, do you have that side of you versus like typical, you know, college students? Or do you guys go out as often, like every day, every night, weekend? Like, I just want to know, like, you know, that side. Thank you.
I just want to say something really fast. What is free time? I don't have free time.
So I have Netflix, Hulu, Amazon Video, and HBO, and I also have my cable network where you can log online and like watch anything. So I love it. So honestly, yeah, free time is really hard to come by, but if you really care, you can make free time for yourself. And in my free time personally, I love binge watching shows. Love it. I also really love internet memes. So you can find me. so you can find me on the interwebs for a very long time. I can't tell you how many times I like accidentally stay up too long, like laughing at jokes online. And then like the next morning, and then like obviously I send them to my roommates, right? And then the next morning I look at them and I'm like, wow, that wasn't even funny. So, but yeah, so that's what I, so like on a less antisocial note, when my roommates and I have some free time, we love to go to Boston and explore. We love eating food. Watch movies together, just hang out together. I personally love just talking to other people in Harvard. Everyone here has just incredible experiences and backgrounds that they can speak to during any conversations. So I, like, freshman year, I'm sure we all did this, where, like, you would just sit in Annenberg Hall, which is, like, a big dining hall. You would just, like, meet new people and, like, ask, like, just talk about everything. So, I did that a lot. I would just, like, stay up all night talking to people. Freshman year was not healthy. But, yeah, so lots of really fun things to do in my free time. Also, a really big fan of face masks. So I love a good night where you can just like face mask, you know, like make some popcorn, some pretzels, binge watch Netflix. Self-care is important.
I agree, and I love free time, so I make it a lot. and I'm from Houston, so everything's very spaced out, so I used to drive all the time, and I became obsessed with driving. In Boston, there aren't really that many. Like, no one has a car in Boston, but I have a Zipcar account, so it's where you can rent a car similar to what you guys have here. And so I take that like once every 2 weeks, sometimes. I've been like 3 times in a day once, just like randomly just take it out with my friends and like drive somewhere, and or just drive when I'm stressed. And I just love that, so I love driving. Took a road trip to New Hampshire a few weeks ago and stuff like that.
Fairly similar. So I'm from the area, so I have a lot of high school friends who go to colleges around. So the big thing that I do is just call them up and grab dinner wherever. And that goes pretty far. So going off what Pushpa said, we once rented a Zipcar on Friday night and drove 2 hours to New Hampshire for fast food that we can get in Boston and then drove back. That's the type of free time we're talking about.
Moving on to the next question from the lady back there. Okay, so what do you like most about Thailand? Like coming to Bangkok, if you like go back to Harvard and your friend asks, what do you find Thailand? How do you find it? What would you tell them?
The people in Thailand are some of the warmest, kindest people I've ever come across. I think I speak for all of us when I say that. Yeah, so I think that's something that's been a really wonderful change. I feel like even though you guys are studying at such a competitive school, you're obviously very stressed, you have a lot of work. I know people have exams while this conference is going on, and so but I'm so impressed at how cheerful and just relaxed and happy you all are. I think that's but like even I don't know. It's just it's a very different atmosphere from Harvard, I think. Being able to set aside your stress, even if it's still with you, is very important. So that's one thing I would say to Harvard people, and maybe even tell them like try to be more like Thai people.
I have this theory that the warmer the temperature, the warmer the people. So, Thai people up here, Boston people not so much. But yeah, so like the weather is amazing, the people like legends, and the food. Oh my god! Like I think everyone knows. Like every meal, I'm just so happy, like about to cry happy. There are two Thai places near Harvard, and they suck. They suck.
And I thought they were good for our kids.
That theory's actually been psychologically proven in the hot weather. But also one of my favorite things I did here was called Muay Thai. Muay Thai was so fun. I'm still a little sore because I think I did it wrong. But that's definitely something I'm going to try to find a place in Boston to do because I loved it.
Any other questions? All right. Since the guys are here almost a week, so I just wonder, like, do you guys face any cultural shock that you want to share? Like the most shocking situation in Thailand that you feel, and watch many aspects from Thailand? Do you have like cultural shock?
Personally, no like cultural shock because I do love traveling, so I've done that. But one thing that has like that really struck me was when we visited the Child Protection Development Center. A lot of us started crying afterwards. Like that was really the. I guess that was a shock in and of itself. Like, we all knew that there are a lot of people who obviously struggle, but I do have a 4-year-old sister and a 12-year-old sister, so you know, seeing their eyes through the eyes of children. For those of you who don't know, you probably do, but it's like a center in Pattaya, and it was children who were, you know, escaped from either human trafficking or other sources, and they're brought into this home, a house of love, and taken to school and stuff. So that was really a very sad but very good moment of time.
So this wasn't necessarily a culture shock, but so just seeing the passion in the different types of people that we've met over this week, I think we just have less. I think that like, so like just meeting the people like at the Sea Turtle Conservatory and the coral planting center and the Child Protective Services Center, they're just all so incredibly happy with the work that they're doing, and like they don't think of it as a job. Like they just like they like the way they described it, like it looked like they woke up to do this job. They went to sleep so they could recharge their energy so they could go back tomorrow and go back to doing this job. So I really, really liked seeing that. It was really refreshing. Yeah.
Also the money, like everything is so cheap here.
Also just the roads. It's crazy just seeing all these like little bikes just kind of zipping in and out. I think I've like crossed the street and had like a fear of death the one too many times as well. That was definitely a culture shock, but I think after a while I've gotten the hang of it. I just kind of walk out, I just kind of go,
and hope for the best. And the time of saw it, Elisha, Maggie, and I went, and that changed my life. And I was so shocked. But I don't, I've never had a massage before, so that might be why, but that Thai massage was amazing.
Okay, thank you very much. My name is Anand. I am one of the faculty members here. And I would like to ask you guys about the ranking, world ranking. And I always see that Harvard is ranked maybe number one or two in the world. And our university is under pressure. Okay. We are supposed to be like one of the top 10. Okay. We should surpass Singapore, right? So I want to ask you guys, okay, how can we bring the university to go to the top of the world as your university? Okay, thank you very much.
I'll just say something real quick. I know that rankings don't are not only academic, but also I believe they take into account the social or the personal lives of the students, how they think their well-being and whatnot. So I think just like keep surveying the students to see what they want and keep, you know, allowing their voice to be shown. And you know, hear them out, and they're saying yes. So just whatever the students want, do that. And it should work. You know, voice of the generation.
Sorry, anyone. One thing that I noticed when I was in high school, just perusing all of the college rankings because you know you don't have anything better to do. So one of the huge things that you usually see stand out is this kind of academic freedom, this ability to not just be stuck in a single track. In talking with a lot of people here at this university and just hearing that if you have to change your track, you start all over again, I think that's a huge hindrance to academic development and like curiosity, because it doesn't necessarily foster this desire to question, to push the boundary. And that's something that a lot of like the high level universities try to foster. So in my very naive perspective, I believe that kind of giving more academic options without having to start over at square one is a good place to it looks like the students agree as well.
So I actually read a case study about like college rankings and stuff, and in the case study it said that like having global programs such as like study abroad or like summer programs is actually like one of the main factors that they like take into account when they do the rankings. So I think it's like it would be like more beneficial to like expand the exchange, either like cultural exchange or like academic exchange, like study abroad programs in general. I feel like Chulalongkorn is already doing pretty well in this, because of like the Thai delegates that I've met, like many of them have done like study abroad in countries in Latin America, I know. but I think just like expanding on that and making it like more accessible and like making it more popular among students would be like very helpful.
Yeah, we've talked to like so many of y'all about your experiences here, and we've really learned so much. And what is the saying? The Chula is the pillar of the kingdom. Like, if you're a pillar of the kingdom, you need to like be progressive. You need to be like one of like a leader for the country. And I think the students want to be the future leaders of the country. They want to be like the head, and they want to like make change. And just I think really like listening to the students, like what we've been talking about, like listening to what the undergraduates want.
Yeah, so a lot of times at Harvard, when we want change, we just demand it. and then it happens. I mean, either like quickly, like quick petition, or a couple protests over the years. But like the idea is that you give students a stake in their education, you know, you give them a voice. You know, students know what they want. I mean, me personally, I'm a student in science and health policy, and something I love is just exploring different questions, right? But I'm not able to explore different questions without Harvard's resources. You know, I would not be able to step foot in a lab if Harvard didn't have someone to fund that lab. Similarly, I would not have been able to like travel anywhere and like learn about like on the ground case study. I know a lot of my friends get funding for their theses. So just having those resources disposed to the students' curiosities is really important. Obviously, Harvard has a big privilege when it comes to resources. It has a pretty large endowment, but even just focusing on the students as a means of, like, as the backbone of education, I think will just make them happier, you know? And we know what we want. We all want this.
Any other questions? We can also translate.
So, I know that you guys have been through tons of interviews and CV writings, but it's not so much here in Thailand, so I would like to ask you guys for some tips for getting yourself across through the interviews and the CVs. Thank you.
So, one thing that I learned after going through 1.5 recruiting seasons through Harvard is that it is difficult to get past the first phase of screening, and I'm speaking from a tech perspective, but I think this is somewhat generally true across all disciplines. But it is somewhat difficult to get past the first screening, which is simply paper, simply your resume or CV. And I think even if you have skills to showcase during an interview, just because of the sheer volume of resumes that companies receive, it's difficult to get that interview. So that is where your personal connections come in. And I think just investing time in recruiting events, expanding your network, talking to people that you may not think will be able to help you, because you never know down the line, that's one thing that has really helped me. I remember during my freshman year applying for dozens of internships solely with the resume. And none of them worked out. I didn't hear back from any of them, and I think that's simply because it was just like it got lost in the sea of resumes. And how I ended up getting my internship was through a friend of a friend who was kind enough to connect me with someone who then took my resume and said, okay, now I will interview you and see if you would be a good fit for this internship. So beyond polishing your resume, I would say that it's really the personal connections that can help you kind of get past that first stepping stone. Having successfully survived and gone through a recruiting season, I think this is important in general for interviews. Obviously, there's all the generic advice of present yourself as the best you and all that other good stuff, don't wear flip flops and whatnot. But I think something that's really important is to just be really honest in terms of both your cover letter and your actual interview. I mean, be your best you, but also you don't want to present yourself as someone who may be a good fit for what you think the job wants, but then if it's not actually a good fit for you and who you actually are, then that won't be a good match anyway. So I think it's really important to be honest. And also aligned and further supported being honest kind of in the whole process. I think a lot of what Elisha just mentioned in terms of kind of getting lost in the sea, a lot of it ultimately, and this sounds terrible because that's true, it's a crapshoot, is a matter of kind of standing out and making an impression. And I think more so than having one more accolade or one more line of some impressive award you have, forming a more honest connection or feeling like an actual person when they read your cover letter or in the interview is something that sticks out more and is more memorable for interviewers. I also say that when I worked at a startup, I interviewed and hired a lot of people. So from that side of it, I think that's honestly something very powerful. And I don't want people to feel like there's one certain special formula that'll get you any job. It's different in different industries, and I don't want people to feel like you have to have a perfect resume or you have to have personal connections to get a job or anything like that. But yeah, just I think being honest is very important.
One tiny note on personal connections, you have all of us now. All of you are welcome to always reach out to us. That's what these kind of events help with, lifelong friends.
And in the end, if it doesn't work out, you won't get the job that you want. Always remember that you can always create your own as well. So just create a path for you that's never been done before. Startups are amazing culture, just do you.
Alright, it was a great session, and can you guys give us some last few words from all of you? That would be great, thank you. Yeah, that's very cool.
Well, I just want to say it was actually a very fun session. I think we all had a lot of fun, and we all had a lot of fun this week in Thailand. It's been a great experience, and I've met so many amazing people and tried so many amazing things and amazing food, and it's just been a great week, so I just want to say thank you for all who came today, and thank you to all the Thai delegates.
Yeah, once again, thank you to everyone, every single one of the Thai delegates, as well as the people who came here. It was truly a magical vacation, or a conference for a week. a little bit of both. I truly think I absolutely fell in love with this country. I look forward to coming back multiple times and reconnecting with every one of you. I wish the best of luck for whatever you do in the future.
Yeah, sure. Thank you so much, all the Bangkok delegates, for hosting us and showing us a great time. I've done HCAP. This is my third year doing HCAP, and this has been like one of the best parts of my experience, like being involved in the organization. And I've actually been to Bangkok before when I was young with my family, but I think there's something very unique about being hosted by college students and also college students who really care about us and just presenting like the best of what this country can offer. So I'm excited to return, and when you ever visit the US, or I'm originally from Korea, so if you're in Korea, always don't hesitate to come.
Where to start? I don't know if I can really put into words the incredible experience that I've had here from all of the HCAP staff, all of the liaisons, and just all of the people at Chulalongkorn. Just, you've been absolutely incredible. And this conference really has just reminded me so much of why I love HCAP and how it can truly foster lifelong connections, and I highly recommend for anyone and everyone to reach out to me if you're ever in the States or if you just want to just talk about whatever. Thank you from the bottom of my heart for everything.
This kind of experience is what I dreamed about when I thought about college as a high school student. I guess going to see different countries and connecting with the people there, I think is one of the most meaningful things one can do in college. It's such a unique time to do that. And I think going back to what Lucia said about not being so different after all, it's just been wonderful to make such good friends that are so far away, but it just feels like we know each other for so long, even after only like exactly 20 days together or something like that. And the hospitality we've experienced here has been unmatched. I'm just so thankful for the whole experience.
I've actually been looking forward to this 7 weeks ago, since the day you guys arrived in the United States. And Alexa stole my thunder, but yes, we are not so different. And I think HCAP, like the genuine friendships that we make here, are incredible. And I hope that we will connect again in the future.
Well, this might sound a bit repetitive for you guys who were at Harvard in January, but this is my fourth year at HCAP, and having joined HCAP kind of on a whim, not really knowing what Harvard College and HCAP program was, to ending up to falling in love with the organization, to become president in my penultimate year here, my final year here. I very intentionally chose Bangkok as my last trip. I planned it out for a while. I knew that it would be down to like here. And it's weird because you've done HCAP for so long and you kind of know how things go, but it's still different and amazing every time. It doesn't feel like fake or superficial, all the people and relationships you make. And I feel this way after every trip, in that by the end of the week, A, it feels like months that we've like known each other, and B, you feel so comfortable saying that you have a home there afterwards. And I just think that all of us will agree in saying that we completely feel at home with you guys, thanks to your wonderful taking care of us and just how much you care. There's no way to say in words, and we just appreciate you guys so much and hope that you guys feel the same in terms of feeling like you always have a home with us. So thank you guys.
Again, thank you guys all for coming to this conference, especially during midterm season. This is my first year doing HCAP, and it was incredible. And I'll of course do it again. If you guys ever visit the States, please let us know. We'd love to
there. So thank you.
So I study psychology, which is chitawitya in Thai, which I think means the like understanding of mind, soul, and heart. And I know that being here this week has really like just filled my mind, my heart, and my soul. Just like everything we've done, the people I've met, just all of the love you guys have shown us is unmatched, unreal. I feel like forever grateful for y'all. And please, yeah, like everyone said, like if you ever are in Boston or Texas or anywhere, please reach out. We're here for you.
So I feel the same exact way as when I was here. There's really no way to say how thankful I am. This has been an incredible week. But I do want to say thank you very, very much to the committee of HCAP. I know you guys took HCAP at half because you took time out of your school. I know a lot of you are taking class. to just show us around and be with us. Literally, like, Penny at the floating market yesterday sat with me while I was getting a fish pedicure for like an hour. It's just been incredible, you know, like little experiences here and there, and we're like friends forever, and I know it's kind of late, so yeah, thank you so much, especially to the committee for organizing this, the liaisons for like dealing with us, and just for all of you for just like being.
Insightful answers. I believe that we all get new knowledge of what it's like in US, in Boston, and I feel like we really get to see the differences and also the similarities between us. I feel like in Chulalongkorn we could really grow from this session if we really reflect upon ourselves as well. And I think I speak for all the committee when I said that we really are happy to have you here.
Up next, we have a traditional show from Petra, Chulalongkorn University. If you are free, you are very welcome to stay. And as well as we do have this closing ceremony. Thank you. Thank you.
Psychology is a very long journey. And it has come to an end. But think about it. Think about how we became friends, like Elijah, like Gia, and the others you guys have mentioned that. How have we become friends in, what, 2 weeks? A week or so, okay, so. But honestly, for all that time, and what we could talk about to each other means a lot more. It doesn't matter how much time you spend together, I've come to realize that. It doesn't matter where you come from. The only thing that matters right now is that we're friends. And we're good friends. And we're the friends that we can look back and smile at those friendships. Yeah, this speech is a closing speech. But I know it is an M and it is sad. It is hard for us all, Bangkok. It's hard for us. Hopefully, it is hard for you guys, but it's okay if it's not. Honestly, but it also marks another thing more than an end. It marks the beginning of us being able to miss each other. And that's actually a good feeling. Because when you miss someone, you know that they have a place in your heart. And that is actually a new beginning. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was such a heartfelt speech that now mine will seem so formal and cold. but I have to do it. So, dear distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, first I'd like to thank you all so much for participating in the Harvard College of Asia Program Bangkok Conference 2018 or HCAP Bangkok. It has been a pleasure meeting all of you. And Chulalongkorn University is honored to have been selected as a partner school of HCAP for the last 6 years. We endeavor to raise our standards and satisfaction quotient during the conference. In the past week, we've been honored to have distinguished speakers speak on various important contemporary leadership issues related to the theme Redefining Leadership, Initiative and Influence in the Modern World. Aware of these issues, we'll be able to cope with any obstacles lying ahead of us with vivid and comprehensive understanding. We truly believe that the exchange of knowledge, perspectives, and culture can create enormous impacts on the mindset of all delegates from various continents. I hope that this year's conference has left and has left an unforgettable impression on all participants, and will enhance an everlasting friendship between the future leaders of Thailand and the United States. We would love to welcome all of you in the audience next year for another successful and educational conference. Thank you all so much. This has been such a meaningful week for all of us.